born December 28, 1927 in Miami, to Lewis Carl Laplin and Mabel Nellie Wells Laplin. I don't know if I pronounced that name. Did I? All right. She went home to heaven to be greeted by Jesus, her Lord and Savior, and multiple family members and friends on Thursday, May 11, 2023 in Canada, at the age of 95 years, 4 months, 13 days. She met and married Robert Boozy Howard on June 14, 1947. He passed away on September 26, 2008. Maxine lived most of her life in Miami and helped raise their 4 children here. She went to work at Bailey Grocery until she retired at the age of 72. She loved the people she worked with and the customers at the store. Maxine was a wonderful cook and was known for her excellent chicken strips, gravy, and okra salad and on special occasions. She was an accomplished seamstress, making everything for her children, which included special clothes for Easter and Christmas. With help from her church family, she made Barbie doll dresses for a GA banquet, bridesmaid dresses, doll clothes, plus mended many jeans. Maxine and her family all attended First Baptist Church in Miami. She loved her church and the members. God gave her a wonderful Christian family while she lived in Miami. She was preceded in death by her parents, her daughter, Pixie Stoner Jones, and a great-great-granddaughter, Elena Stoner. Survivors include her 2 sons, David Howard and wife Patsy, and Don Ed Howard, daughter, Marsha Howard Tennant, and husband Rick, 9 grandchildren, 15 great-grandchildren, and 5 great-great-grandchildren. Let me pray. Father, we come to you this morning, this evening, this afternoon, Father, as we come to remember Maxine Howard. And Father, I know that the family is grieving, and Father, I pray for your comfort and your peace. And knowing that because Jesus walked out of the grave, this is not goodbye. This is, we'll see you later. And Father, I pray and ask for your comfort and your peace on the family. Father, we love you. And we thank you so much, Father, for your son, Jesus. And the death that he died for us and that he walked out of that grave 3 days later. Father, we love you. Again, I pray for comfort and peace in the family. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
If you could join me in singing.
We shall meet on that beautiful shore. I came here in 2006, it was busy in Maxine. But as I started visiting over there, they always welcomed their pastor. And they were a family that loved God and loved God. And when Boozy went on to be with the Lord after that, I was always welcome when I came by to visit Maxine. It was rather heartbreaking as part of Miami EMS to have made the run that had changed, had her life changed. For she really stopped being Maxine as we knew it. But she still was a lovely woman, always welcomed me when I went to visit her in the nursing home. And right now, though, it's hard to grieve too much because she's Maxine as she was. Actually, Maxine as she's never been before. She really, really isn't. She's in a wonderful place, the Bible says. There's no more crying, tears, nor pain. She is in heaven. And I know that beyond a shadow of a doubt. And that's why we're here at this celebration service. You know, the scripture says in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 1, a good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of death better than the day of birth. Now, in a sense, that's kind of an interesting statement. But if you think about it, on the day of a person's birth, you know, there is great joy amongst all the family, but the one who's been born has had a pretty traumatic experience occur to them. They've been in the safety of a womb, then squished out through the birth canal into bright lights and noise, and usually they're squabbling. But on the day of one's death, there are many that are grieving, but if you think about the loved one who's gone to be in heaven, into heaven, oh my goodness. We'll talk about that here in just a little bit. But I'm so grateful to be able to stand here and offer the words of comfort that come from the scripture. The Bible says too in Psalm 116, verse 15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And this was a precious holy one. Psalm 90, verse 10 says, the length of our days is 70 years, or 80 if we have strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass, and we will fly away. If one is strong and lives to be 80, Maxine was a strong lady to live to be 95. My. But as we gather here, someone was asking me, preacher, what are you going to say? And I say, I'm going to say the things I normally say at a funeral because you don't need the things that Dennis Williams has to say. You need the things that God has already said. And there's so much here. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, a very familiar passage if you've ever been to a funeral that I've done, but a passage that I love to read at a time like this. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in verse 3, and when you hear me read it, just kind of think about the word comfort, and if you want to, count how many times that God puts in these short verses the word comfort or comforted. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ flow over into our lives, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. And if we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, you also share in our comfort. If I remember right, I've used that word comfort about 8 times. God had it written about 8 times. Now, I'm a parent, and we are grandparents, and one of the teaching tools is repetition. When you're trying to make a point to loving children and grandchildren, you repeat yourselves. Well, I think in this case, God is trying to make a point to you that he is here to comfort you. He really, really is. Now, of course, one of the ways he comforts us in a situation like this is he uses others. Now, though Maxine was 95 and transitioned into heaven, she will be missed. And there's a number in this congregation whose mamas have also gone to heaven. My mother, Opal, went to heaven at the age of 70. she, like Maxine, was having some health problems. A mom that had been fighting cancer for 8 years. And I think, you know, I was just pondering that after she passed. And I wondered, you know, if I went to see a woman, you know, contact her and say, okay, would you like to come back as you were? She would have smiled and said no. Because she was in a much better place. But Marcia, there's lots of people here who have also buried their homeless. And they'll be there to help. They're really, really good. But also God will use his word. And that's one of the reasons why I shared this. Because the Bible says the grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of God lies forever. You don't ever need what a preacher has to say. You need what God has to say. Because his word is true. And it is there to give us comfort. It is there to give us strength. Now, some of the things that are found in the Bible that are there to help us. God, pardon me. But do you know what one of the, when we think about death, what Jesus' favorite word for death was and what the Bible's favorite word for death is? It's sleep. In John chapter, or in Acts chapter 13, verse 36, it is written, for when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. In Mark chapter 5, verses 37 through 39, you know, he was going into a little girl's room, and he said he did not let anybody follow him there except Peter, James, and John. When they came to the home of the synagogue ruler, Jesus saw a commotion with the people crying and wailing loudly. He said, wow, the commotion, wow, the wailing. The child is not dead, but is asleep. When Jesus had heard about Lazarus and known that he had died, he said this, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. Very familiar passage of scripture, 1 Thessalonians verse 4, verse 13. It says, brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or grieve like the rest who have no hope. A favorite word in the Bible for those who die is sleep. And that is not a bad thing. You know, I think about the end of the middle of a long day, perhaps, and, you know, being able to lean back in the recliner and after a good meal and take a nap, go to sleep for a little while. That's just nice. That's refreshing. A habit in my life, a discipline in my life, is a Sunday afternoon nap. I dearly love my Sunday afternoon nap, and I wake up refreshed. When I think about sleep for a believer, what a wonderfully refreshing word that is, that's what God uses to describe death. But also the Bible tells us certain things that occurred when Maxine in the nursing home in Canadian closed her eyes here on earth. There was an angel who appeared to take her into the presence of God. In Luke chapter 16, the scripture in its larger context talks about a rich man who ended up going to hell, not because he was rich, because he did not trust the Lord. But let me read the passage of scripture. It says, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day, and his gates was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores, and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. And even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. What a wonderful thought to think that even though if Maxine's eyes were closed, you know, that finally that strong heart stopped beating and she found herself no longer in the realm of the living. She didn't have to wonder aimlessly about where she was going. There was an angel prepared to carry her into the presence of God. The angel did it for this beggar named Lazarus, and the angel was there waiting. A prepared angel was there waiting to carry Maxine into the presence of God. You know, we'll talk about traveling in style. I've used this phrase before, but you know, a lot of times we have fancy vehicles, but just think about traveling in the arms of an angel. What an awesome, awesome thing. She went to a place, a very special place. When Jesus was crucified on the cross, the Bible tells us in Luke chapter 23, verse 39 through 43, it says, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him and says, aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him and said, don't you fear God, since you are indeed under the same sentence, we are being punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then the man said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, truly, I tell you truly, today you will be with me in paradise. Now, Jesus is referred to as the living word. And Jesus knew how to use words in a powerful way. Read his sermons. Read the Sermon on the Mount and hear his words over and over and over again. He knew how to use language in a wonderful, powerful way. And yet when he described what we have prepared for us in glory, his one-word description of it was paradise. Paradise. And that's where Maxine is right now. She is in that place described by Jesus as paradise. There are other times when the scripture says that, it really can't, the words aren't adequate anyway. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, eyes not seen, no eyes seen, no ears heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Heaven, where she is right now, is a place beyond words and a place beyond experience. And of course, she's in a prepared place, a prepared lady. Jesus was, on the day before he died, he was giving words to his disciples that were going to prepare them for his death. And in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3, he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Maxine, at some point in her life, I don't know that I ever remember asking about her conversion experience, but I know that at some time in the past, the distant past, she gave her heart to Jesus Christ. And it wasn't just something she did one day and then forgot it. This, her membership in this church, y'all being here, you know, you could tell me stories about Maxine and her faith. She lived her faith day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. She lived her life loving Jesus and serving him. And all that she did was preparation for a wonderful place in heaven that was built by Jesus with the things that she sent ahead. Now, of course, of all the things that are there to help us is the presence of the Lord is the greatest. Psalms 23:4, which is that's the shepherd song. It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. But verse 4 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Hebrews 13:5 says, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. God does use his people, he uses his words, but he comes by our side himself. That word comfort that I referred to back earlier at the beginning of the message at times, that word literally means he comes by our side. It is just not just some warm fuzzy feeling that will go away, but he stands by our side day by day, minute by minute, for the rest of our lives. That's who he really is. And that's who he is for you as a family. He's here to comfort you by his word with others, but especially by his presence. When I think about Maxine, I know this, that she would be mad at me, and I would dishonor her memory if I did not point each and every one of you to the Jesus that she died serving. The Bible tells us that the only way to get to heaven is by trusting Jesus Christ and living for him. Maxine didn't just do, like I said, Maxine didn't just do that years ago, and then that's it. She gave her heart to Christ as her Savior and Lord. She was faithful to love him, faithful to serve him until the day that she couldn't. And that's the kind of life that we are called on. And if you ever want to see Maxine Howard again, if you want to make sure that you see Maxine Howard again, make sure that you trust Jesus Christ for Savior And you're still your singer the same three way that she did. And I tell you, like I said, I'm doing this knowing that I want to stand there and have her say, "Yes, Brother Dennis." You know, at my home going, you make sure that people knew she was just that kind of person. Maxine loved Jesus and she wants you to love Jesus. And as I said, if you want to see her again, you make sure that you trust Jesus Christ for yourself. He says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Salvation is a gift, but if you don't receive it, it's a payment. Trust the same Jesus. You know Maxine. Trust the same Jesus that she lived. Trust the same Jesus that she died. And you will see her again. And give a wonderful meeting to her home. Trust Christ. Let's pray. There's so much more I could say here. There is. Because Maxine was a wonderful woman of faith. As I said, I you know, after Boozy passed, and she was just a heartbroken widow. She was just focused. She knew her husband, you know, she knew that you loved her and knew where Boozy had gone because of his trust in you. And she knew she'd see him again because she trusted you. And I just thank you for that kind of faith. I'm here, though, lifting up the family, you know, and just pointing them to the same Jesus that she died trusting. That they will lean on him because you're there. And I pray for her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren. That they too will make sure that they trust the same Jesus that she lived and died for. I do thank you for the people that have turned out.
You can start it from the first.
And I just pray that, you know, we've drawn comfort and strength from you in your word. And just thank you for